Christians. How can you expect Muslims to be civilized when the Americans, the Israelis, the Russians kill thousands of Muslim civilians and dismiss it as collateral damage? The Holy Quran permits an eye for an eye. If the unbelievers kill our civilians, we have the right to do the same.
Allah permits retaliation only against the guilty party, not against innocents.
They are used as a centerpiece of many a motion picture and television series. The sleeper cell, where in our own backyards, radicals seeking nothing more than revenge are harbored, sometimes taught to wait quietly and then, when told, kill as many people as possible. The French are now dealing with looking deeper into what was undoubtedly a sleeper cell that rose up and killed journalists and hostages. And while we may not want to talk about it, we in America need to face the cold fact they are here and they are waiting. Let's welcome to Midpoint Israeli-born columnist, Shillman Journalism Fellow at the David Horowitz Freedom Center, reporting on issues facing more than just the Middle East. Daniel Greenfield joins us today. Daniel, thanks so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Daniel, when I look people in the eye and say that they are here and they are waiting, am I guilty of hyperbole?
That's absolutely true. Even a liberal Democrat like Senator Dianne Feinstein has said it. And if Dianne Feinstein, who is unwilling to admit the basic facts of life when it comes to terrorism, can say it, then it's definitely absolutely true and there's no debate about it.
How can we then say it? Because you will get the people on the street who'll say, okay, it's easy for you to say this, Ed and Daniel, but what's the proof?
The proof is that we have extensive intelligence. The CIA officials have said it. Dianne Feinstein, who's on the National Intelligence Defense Committee, has said it. And the basic fact is that we have people coming in from Syria who have been fighting there, have been committing war crimes, have been committing genocide in Syria and Iraq. They're coming back to the United States like the people who carried out the attack in France. They already have pseudo-military training. They have weapons experience. They have battlefield experience. And that makes them extremely dangerous. Now, we can call them a sleeper cell. We can call them dangerous terrorists on our block. But it all comes down to the same thing.
Daniel, I'm going to hit you with another word here that when this subject comes up, I'm often talked to in different conversations. People say, Ed, you're being paranoid. That's all you are. These people are out there, and all they want to do is they want to foment problems with an Islamic community. These are racists. These are far right-wingers. All they are is simply just paranoid, and you're buying into it. You get said the same thing. You hear that. What would you answer back?
It's not paranoia when they're actually trying to kill you. And since September 11th, I don't think any American can really say that it isn't happening, that it's not a reality, and that it's paranoia. Every other week, every other month, brings new headlines from America, from Europe, from Asia, from around the world of terrorist attacks taking place or terrorist plots being broken up. So this is just a reality outside. Denying it is like denying that the sun is going up in the morning.
Are we also at the point where, if we're looking at the sleeper cell issue, if you will, that it is more than just Islamic sleeper cells? Because again, as I mentioned, movies and TV, they have a great way of using this as fodder. They talk about Russian sleeper cells, Chinese sleeper cells, so many others, Pakistani. Is it that widespread? Are we talking about sleeper cells of more denominations than we could possibly count?
These days we're dealing with Islamic terrorism. We've been dealing with Islamic terrorism for quite a while. The last non-Islamic terrorist groups that we've been dealing with in any significant way were usually backed by the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union collapsed. All those groups went away. In the Middle East, they were displaced by Islamic terrorist groups. Domestically, they've been displaced by Islamic terrorist groups. When we look at the terrorist attacks that have happened in the last decade and the last two decades, we're looking at Islamic terrorist groups.
If we know they're there, and if the French know they're there, and the English know they're there, why aren't we doing a better job, and why are we so far behind in actually trying to find them and root them out?
The Europeans, the French, and the English are actually taking some small steps. They're looking closely for if somebody comes back from Syria and they've committed atrocities, they've been aligned with Al-Qaeda, they've actually discussed criminal possibilities or removing their citizenship. In the United States, that's been completely off the table. The Obama administration has said that they're not going to even look at those things. Those are not even options. So actually, we're way behind the French when it comes to dealing with this.
Daniel, I got a couple of different groups that are sitting here in front of me right now that we have talked about. We've discussed with different intelligence agencies that we understand as well that these are two groups that we need to be aware of, because we constantly hear about Al-Qaeda. We hear about these different groups that we know the names of very well. But here's two groups that I had not heard of before, the Lashkar-e-Taiba, one of the largest and most active terrorist organizations in South Asia, operating mainly from Pakistan, and the Jamaat al-Fukra, who is mostly African-American Muslims based in Pakistan and the United States. Are these people, to your best knowledge, are these other groups that we need to be worried about, these ones whose names we can barely pronounce?
When it comes to terrorist groups, when it comes to domestic sleeper cells, the name of the terrorist group is not that important. For example, two of the attackers in the French attack were aligned with Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula. One of them pledged allegiance to ISIS. This kind of thing is in many ways optional. For example, September 11th was a terrorist attack that was planned and plotted and carried out largely by operatives from outside the country. When we're dealing with attackers who are of American citizenship, some of whom may have been born in the United States, these people can say they can stand behind an ISIS flag, they can say that they're with Al-Qaeda. It doesn't make that big of a difference because it's up to them who they want to affiliate with.
All right, Daniel, got about 90 seconds left here. How do we root them out? What are we not doing, or what are we not doing effectively enough as an intelligence agency and a society to find them and catch them?
Well, the most basic thing that we should be doing to prevent the same kind of attack that happened in France is if somebody is coming back from fighting in Syria and fighting in Iraq, we should not only be taking a very close look at them, we should be looking at ways to remove their citizenship or to simply ban them from re-entering the United States. Because if you have people who have already trained with Al-Qaeda coming into the United States, that's the same scenario that led to the World Trade Center bombing. It's the same scenario that led to September 11th. We have to cut these people off at the root, which means preventing them from entering the United States.
Is it inevitable that we are going to start one day looking at every single individual that crosses a border, whether it be by foot, plane, or train?
Either we're going to attack this intelligently, which means profiling, which means looking at probable suspects, or we're just going to have the kind of messy police state we have now that anybody who's traveled to an airport and experienced the TSA knows what it is. We either go smart or we either go stupid broad police state, which is what we have now.
I got about 15 seconds left. What's your opinion of those people who say, how dare you profile? You shouldn't dare do that.
You can either live in the real world or you can live in denial. And when you live in denial, the terrorists can still kill you.
That's pretty much a very emphatic statement to make. And people need to realize that we're not talking about fantasy here. We're talking about reality on a day-to-day basis. Daniel Greenfield, always a pleasure to have you on the show. Thank you so much for your comments.
Thank you for having me.
My pleasure. After the break, Bulls, Bears, and Bucks had a somewhat questionable shopping season that was supposed to be a whole lot better than what we were told. And at 51 minutes after the hour, and telling it like it is, people are talking about leadership, the fraud of leadership shown by people like Oprah Winfrey. That's coming up right here on Midpoint.